Okay, you're all set.
Good morning and thank you for attending today's Pearson Wastewater Treatment Facility monthly construction meeting for the month of May 2020. I'm going to start the meeting by reading the New Hampshire RSA that allows for these meetings to be held by Zoom type format. Per New Hampshire RSA 91A:2, paragraph 3B, the chair has declared that the COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04, section 8, as extended by executive order 2020-09 and emergency order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any person present with them at that location. We'll do that in a moment. Those who are interested in participating in the public comment portion, we'll go through the presentation. And when we open it up for public comment, if you could raise your hand by using the raise hand symbol, we will then go ahead and walk through all those who are interested in having public comment. If you're joining by telephone, press *9 to alert the host that you'd like to speak. When the chair calls on you to speak, the moderator will enable your audio and unmute your microphone. With that, we have to start by with the panelists introducing themselves, saying where they're at and who's with them. My name is Terry Damaris. I'm the city engineer. I'm in Elliott, Maine at my home, and I have children and a sitter here in the house with me. John?
John Pearson from AECOM, the engineering firm working with the city on the project. I am at my home in Merrimack, Mass, and my wife is downstairs working as well.
Peter Rice, Director of Public Works. I'm in my office by myself, but there's numerous staff around the building, but I am in my office by myself.
Hi, this is Andy Broder from Methuen Construction. I am actually on site out at Pierce Island in my office by myself, but there are other folks here working on the job site.
Thank you all. Okay, so here today we have the topics of discussion. We have done introductions. AECOM will go through and discuss the work completed since the last meeting. Andy Broder from Methuen will go through and talk about work coming up in the next 6 months. We'll provide a summary of the project construction costs, outline the schedule associated with the consent decree, and now the rest of the remaining components of the project. Touch on events and recreation. And then take public input for this meeting and the time of the next meeting. Just as a brief reminder here, we do have a public website that we keep up to date on the project, and that link is provided on this slide here. With that, I'll pass it over to John Pearson to continue on with the presentation.
Thank you, Terry. What you see on the screen now is a site plan of the facility as it will appear once construction of the upgrade is completed. And we've highlighted in red the major areas where there's been ongoing activity in the last month or so. And as we normally do, we'll go through each of these areas with some photographs to give you a sense of what's been going on. And then Andy can talk about what's coming up next. So if we could move to the next slide, please. By way of background, this is an aerial photograph looking east towards the treatment facility as it appeared just as construction got started in the fall of 2016. You can see some excavation in the upper right of the photograph, and that is the area where the new Headworks building now is located. So that's what it looked like in the fall of 2016. If we could go to the next slide, it'll show a current aerial photograph of the activity on site. Similar viewpoint looking east towards downtown with the island in the foreground. You can now see the Headworks building in the upper right corner, and the other areas where there's been ongoing activity are highlighted by the red callouts. So we'll go through each of these, and let's start today with the site work, which would be the next slide. With the advent of spring, the final grading and restoration activities have resumed. These are a couple of photographs showing some of the ongoing final grading, loaming and leading to seeding. And as in addition to loaming and seeding and establishing final grades, landscaping work has begun as well to restore the site to its final condition. Just a couple of shots. The photo on the left, you're looking towards the primary clarifiers with the solids building in the background, showing the loam being placed on the disturbed areas. Photo on the right is of the headworks area, taken from the road leading up to the facility, again showing some of the final grading in preparation for final restoration. Next slide, please. Couple of more photographs of some of the ongoing restoration work. The photo on the left is on the west side of the facility along what's known as the vegetated maintenance corridor, looking towards gravity thickener number 2, which is the dome tank in the foreground and the solids building behind it, showing some of the grade stakes and the construction of that vegetated maintenance corridor. Photo on the right is looking to the south between the two primary clarifiers with the solids building in the background, and you can see the beginnings of the subgrade for the walkways to allow personnel to walk along between the different facilities on site. So that activity continues. Next slide, please. This is a little bit later shot of the same general area we just saw. Now that the gravel's been placed and the subgrade for the sidewalks is much more apparent on the photo on the left. So those sidewalks would be placed. And the photo on the right is looking towards the grit building. The dome structure in the background to the left is gravity thickener number 1. The tank in the foreground is one of the primary clarifiers. So work to restore the site is well underway and will continue in the current month, as you'll hear shortly from Andy Broder. Next slide, please. Turning now to the operations lab building, this has been the focus of the majority of activity in the last month. This is the last major building to be constructed as part of the project. It was the former sludge processing building, which the first floor was demolished. The hazardous materials have been removed at this point, and the conversion of the foundation to the new ops lab building is well underway. Photograph on the left is the lower level of the building. The masonry has been completed on the interior. The damp proofing is the black material you'll see in the photo on the left. That was followed by insulation and then the face brick, which is what you see going up in the photo to the right. The building, when completed, will have a masonry facade on the lower level and a metal panel facade on the upper level. That work is well underway. Next slide. Another couple of views of the operations lab building. Photo on the right shows the structural steel being installed that will create the upper level. And the photo on the left is a bit later in time showing the completed structural steel that was installed. So the building is beginning to take shape, and that area is seeing a lot of activity, as you'll hear shortly. Next slide, please. A couple of more photos of the operations lab building. The photo on the left shows that what will be the new entrance stairs up to the operations lab building that will house all the administrative functions for the facility on site. Photo on the right shows some of the roof joists that have been placed on the structural steel we saw in the last photo as the next step in beginning to create the enclosed first floor. Next slide, please. In the lower level of building, there's also been a tremendous amount of activity. You see a couple of shots here of the interior wall going up. In order to bring the building up to today's energy codes, new insulation was added, and that insulation was protected with a thin CMU or concrete masonry unit wall, and that's what you see being installed on the left, and a shot of a completed wall on the right. So work is ongoing within the building. And you can also see above the workers in the photo on the left, some of the rough-in for plumbing and the other services within the building. Next slide, please. A couple of more photographs within the building, the creation of the interior spaces and some of the reinforcing that will be used for some of the equipment pads being installed. Again, this is the lower level of the ops lab building, and you can see overhead that some of the rough-in plumbing has progressed from what we saw in the last photo. Next slide, please. The functions of the lower level of the ops lab building will still be a process space. It will house some of the chemical systems as well as some of the pumping systems, and because of the presence of the chemical systems, containment walls are required in the event there is ever a failure of any of the piping that will release chemicals. The containment walls contain it so that it doesn't escape and it can be properly captured and disposed of. So on the photo on the left, you see the beginnings of reinforcing for those containment walls. The white material along the floor is actually a water stop that makes that a watertight joint where the new walls are added to the floor. And the photo on the right shows the concrete that's been placed for those containment curbs and the formwork in place, and that concrete is in the process of curing in that photograph. So there's been a lot of activity in that building, and that's really been the hub of activity. And I will ask Andy Broder to pick up at this point and give us a look ahead for this month and then the following 6 months.
Hey, thanks, John. Looking at the work to be completed in the coming month, we'll be going back to some of the other buildings and continuing minor finish work. So that would be the headworks, grit, solids, and bath buildings. We'll be continuing to progress with the startup of the bath building process work. Continue the interior touch-up painting in the building, so the bath, solids, and grit buildings. Again, at the bath building, continuing the integration of the control system with the plant SCADA system, get those two things integrated, and to complete the outstanding work and startup of the gravity thickener number 2 mechanism. Next slide, please. Going back over to the operations building, the structural steel metal roof decking will be completed, and then the interior metal studwork, framing, interior masonry, and exterior brickwork will all be continuing. The mechanical process work down in the basement that you saw some of the plumbing work already started, that'll be moving along with the HVAC, electrical, and continuation of the plumbing work that you already saw as well in the lower level. And then again, moving outside, we'll be preparing for more plantings and continue the installation of the landscaping. Now, looking ahead, say for another 5 or 6 months, the moving over to the headworks building, the plan is to finish the installation of all the chain link fence and the gate around that building. And to complete the plantings and all the landscaping north and west of the building. You see in the lower left-hand corner of the photo. At the grit building, again, I'll be just wrapping up whatever punch list items are in there. The bath building, continuing the landscaping, and then the chain link fence, again, around the perimeter of that building. That kind of shows where you see the site work up in that right-hand corner of the drawing. At the solids building, again, punch list items more than anything else, and completing the plantings and the landscaping around that building as well, down near gravity thickener number 2. As John had mentioned before, the majority of the work is gonna be at the operations building and then finishing up some finish work outside. So at the operations building, in the next 5 to 6 months, we'll be completing all the exterior masonry, completing all the metal wall panels that John had mentioned before, everything on the outside skin of the building, so that completes the roofing system as well. Moving to the inside of the building, we would complete all the interior framing, sheeting, and painting. Continue the installation of laboratory casework and equipment inside the lab at the east end of the building. You saw some of the pictures of the rough-in work there. All of that would be completed, including the installation of the equipment associated with that work. We would also complete the installation of all the finished floor systems. So it's a combination of ceramic tile, VCT, and vinyl sheet flooring. We would complete the installation of all the exterior windows and doors, again, trying to get that shell all wrapped up. At the same time, we'll be completing all the interior chemical fill installations as well. Moving outside down to where the area of the clarifiers and the primary clarifier effluent D-box, we will be installing and painting added turnbuckles at the clarifiers, as well as installing revised gratings at the PCE D-box. That takes us pretty much to the outside site work. We would place the remainder of the binder course roadway paving, which would be east of the ops building. We would finish up with all the concrete sidewalks, stairs, and ramps at the operations building, complete the remaining final grading and landscape activities,
And that would include grading and placing asphalt walkways on the stone mow strips. We will complete the installation of the rain garden area, which is just west of gravity thickener number one. And then to wrap the rest of the smaller items up, we would complete the installation of guard posts and bollards around the site, as well as all the permanent chain link fence. That pretty much covers everything we'll be doing in the next, say, 5 to 6 months.
John, you're
right. I was on mute. I said, turning now to project construction costs. This slide summarizes the original contract amount and the 9 change orders to date. Change order 9 is in the process of being executed this month for $240,000 approximately, which brings the contract total to just over $75 million in total cost. Next slide, please. Turning now to schedule. This slide summarizes the consent decree milestones that were implemented during the course of the project, as well as the status. As you can see, all have been achieved except for the last, which is really a compliance with the requirement of the consent decree, which begins in June to meet a monthly limit of 8 milligrams per liter total nitrogen. And as you'll see in some of the data we'll show shortly, we are on the path to achieving that as well. So far, so good. Next slide, please. This slide, as we've been doing for the last couple of months, summarizes some of the effluent results to show a compliance with the what's called the NPDES, or National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System permit, which is the document that governs the quality of the discharge from the treatment facility. The two parameters shown here in the bar graph are biochemical oxygen demand, or BOD, which is a measure of the organic strength of the effluent, and total suspended solids, or TSS, is a measure of the solids in flow. Both of those parameters have a stipulated limit of an average of 30 milligrams per liter each month, which is the red bar. And then the two different color bars show on a monthly. As you can see, they are well below the required limit of 30 milligrams per liter. So we're very pleased with the performance to date in that those parameters. Next slide, please. As we mentioned, the last milestone is compliance with the consent decree requirement for total nitrogen in the effluent, which has a value that begins in June 1st of this year, that we have to achieve a monthly average of 8 milligrams per liter or less. And this presents the data, even though we haven't had to be in compliance with that yet, showing that the total nitrogen is trending downwards as we expected it would. And we're on the path to achieve that effluent limit by the requirement of June 1st. So the total nitrogen level is dropping and will continue to do so as the biological aerated filter process continues in its startup and biomass development phase. Next slide, please. This month, we added a couple of extra slides just to kind of summarize some of the things we've been talking about in the last few meetings. The facility went online or was put into service at the beginning of the year. That's not to say construction is done. As we just talked about, construction on the operations lab building and some of the minor other items that don't affect the process operation is ongoing. But in essence, this is a schematic of the facility as it stands today, and essentially all of these processes are in operation today. This shows the schematic of the various elements of the treatment process, including the wet weather, the liquid flow path, and also how solids are handled at the facility. And we will turn to the next slide and we can walk through each of those steps and where they are physically on site to give you a little better sense of what's occurring throughout the treatment process. This is the same aerial view that we showed a little while ago with some additions to kind of highlight the flow and the flow path. So let's take it right from the beginning, that all the wastewater that gets to Pierce Island is pumped off the island by the Mechanic Street pump station. It's through what's called a force main, conveyed up to the headworks, which is the first step in the treatment process. The headworks contains screens to remove large objects that are contained in the flow. That is the first step in the process. And that's also the first location where monitoring of the quality of the wastewater coming in is required by the city's NPDES permit. So that yellow box highlight, that's where the raw wastewater, as we call it, is sampled and monitored so we know the quality coming in. Flow from the headworks then flows underground along that blue dotted flow path you see there to the grit building, which is the second step in the process. Grit is essentially sand, coffee grounds, and other abrasive materials that we want to remove from the flow because it has a negative effect on downstream process equipment. So the grit chamber does the function of removing that grit and allows the grit-free effluent to be discharged onto the next process, which are the two round primary clarifiers. Clarification is a step where it's a large tank where we create quiet conditions that allow the heavy materials in the wastewater to settle to the bottom, where there's a rotating raking mechanism that scrapes that material to a center hopper where it's pumped away for subsequent treatment. The clarified effluent comes off the top of the clarifiers and then proceeds on to the next step. So we have what's called primary effluent at that point. Primary effluent flows into a wet well, which is a holding tank where pumps draw out of, and that flow is then pumped by a series of pumps located in the solids building up to the heart of the treatment process, which is the biological aerated filter system, or BAF. And as we've talked in previous meetings, and as you saw in the last schematic, the BAF consists of two stages. Stage one are the largest black cells that you see on the left-hand side of the building. And in those, in that first stage, the carbonaceous or the organic material is treated. And also the ammonia that's present in the wastewater, the raw wastewater that comes in, is converted biologically from ammonia to nitrate, a different form of nitrogen. But it's the first step in removing the nitrogen is to convert the ammonia into nitrate. Flow from the stage one flows by gravity into the second stage, which are the smaller series of black cells on the right-hand side of the BAF building. And then on its way to that second stage, a carbon source is added to provide the chemical energy that the microorganisms need to convert the nitrate that we created in stage one into nitrogen gas, which is stripped off to the atmosphere. That's really the nitrogen removal mechanism. The effluent from stage two then flows through an underground pipe. There's a dotted blue line showing the flow path. So it's the secondary effluent. That flows to a distribution box just ahead of the disinfection step. Now you may recall that a part of the city's collection system is what's called a combined sewer system, that some of the street drainage and other drainage facilities are tied into the sewer system. So occasionally during wet weather, and a significant wet weather event is required, not all of the flow will pass through the BAF. During dry weather, all flow goes through the secondary treatment process. During significant storms, a portion of that flow will not pass through the BAF. It'll be bypassed around through the orange flow path that's labeled wet weather. It goes around the BAF and it joins the treated effluent from the biological aerated filter just ahead of the disinfection step. As part of the project implementation, the vendor for the biological aerated filter system, Kruger, has provided a bonded performance guarantee that the effluent from the BAF will be able to achieve total nitrogen of 3 milligrams per liter or less under winter conditions, which is a temperature of about 10 degrees C. So at all times, nitrogen will be removed from the effluent that passes through the BAF. That secondary effluent is recombined with any flow during a significant storm that doesn't pass through the BAF in the D-box just ahead of the disinfection system. And the combined effluent is disinfected to meet the effluent requirements for bacteria and viruses. Sodium hypochlorite is added at that point to disinfect the wastewater, and a second chemical, sodium bisulfite, is added just before discharge to remove any remaining traces of the sodium hypochlorite before the final effluent is sampled in the location you see called out in yellow, just before it enters the outfall pipe where it's discharged to the Piscataquis River. So that's a kind of an overview of what's on site, and essentially all of these facilities are now in service, providing secondary treatment to the wastewater. Next slide, please. At this point, we would normally talk about some of the events that in the area of Pierce Island, so we interact and do not affect them, but with the current COVID situation, there have not been any events scheduled at this time. Harry can pick up.
Thank you, John. So this slide here shows some of the intended additional items that the city's looking at completing. We're in the midst of working with the contractor to review the final schedule. The intended original completion date was in the September timeframe of this year. There has been some delays resulting from just the progress of construction and some related to the COVID issue. So we're reevaluating the schedule. There's also a number of areas that we had other intended work on the island, and those include raising the road and constructing a new parking lot in what was the old snow dump area, restoring the staging areas that have been used on the island, and in particular, restoring the area of the pool, existing pool parking lot. We also are intending to replace the water main and upsize that from the pool bathhouse out to the Pearson Road Bridge. So we're currently in the midst of working on all of those items and determining what the impact of that might be on the overall schedule for the treatment plant work. So that is to be determined at this time, but we're working hard on that particular item. At this point in time, we would generally take public input and comments. It doesn't appear that we have any attendees beyond the four panelists at this time. Unless I'm missing something, but I believe that's it. So we're going to move on to summarize the next meeting, which will be June 17th at 11 a.m. The exact format is yet to be determined, whether that will be a Zoom meeting or an in-person meeting, but that's to be determined. Please pay attention to the agenda for the next meeting when that meeting gets closer. With that, we'll conclude the meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.